Your Eminences, Reverend Fathers, dear brothers and sisters in Christ, our beloved students of the Master Program in Orthodox Ecumenical Theology. Today, it is a special occasion for two reasons. This public lecture from the teaching staff of the program is quite important because women's issue occupy the theological debate for a long time now. Most importantly, however, is the speaker of today's presentation, the presentation on the position of women in the Orthodox Church, Martha or Maria. The presenter is the president of the Center of Ecumenical, Missiological and Environmental Studies, Metropolitan and the layman Papageorgiou, with the acronym SEMES. And this is important because this program was set up by the academic members of SEMES. And you know that how difficult it is to set up a program of such a special orientation. And before I present to you our today's speaker, Professor Niki Papageorgiou, because she is the president, the current president of this foundation, it is important to say a few words about our vision, our orientation, our contribution to the setting up of this program, because from the time this foundation was set up exactly 10 years ago, 10 years now, next month, April 2011, was the official inauguration of the existence of this ecumenical, missiological, and environmental foundation. An occasion which our foundation will celebrate probably at the beginning of next month, April. Now, our present speaker, Professor Niki Papageorgiou, is a professor of sociology in sociology of religion and social ethics at the Theological Faculty, the Department of Theology, the Theological School of the Aristotle University of Thessaloniki. And in addition to her ecumenical interests, she is also, I call her, a practical missionary. She was involved in many missionary activities, both in the Far East and in Africa. I think she is currently teaching also in the theological school in Congo, together with other members of SEMES and of the Theological Faculty of the University of Thessaloniki. And this makes me quite happy that one of the visions of this academic program of the master program in Orthodox Ecumenical Theology was also its missionary orientation. I don't want to say more about her academic achievements, because the subject which is going to be presented today is quite important. I remember her also as a co-editor of the major international conference we had 5 or 6 years ago on the theme Deaconesses, Ordination of Women and Orthodox Theology. And exactly in that conference, she was also she was presenting a similar subject. And I'm very glad that the discussion which will follow will enhance our awareness about the place of women both in our scientific field, but also in our mission, in our witness of our church. Professor Papageorgiou, the floor is yours now for the next, say, half an hour to present us your subject.
Thank you very much, Professor Vasiliadis. Thank you very much. Reverend Father, dear students, good afternoon. My topics today is just a moment to share. It's okay. So my topic is the position or the place of women in the Orthodox Church, Martha or Maria, Martha or Mary. Let's begin introduction with introduction. The question of the position of women in the Christian Church, the roles that arise from this position, emerged with the evolution of the modern world, which influenced in various ways the position of women in society in general and reshape the gender roles. It is well known that the socioeconomic transformations that led to the transition from the traditional to the modern society created new socioeconomic conditions for the empowerment of women in society. The industrialization, the urbanization, the exodus of women in the labor market, the detachment of people from traditional community structures and the possibilities to decide freely for his life and for his social roles, the claim of equal participation in politics, etc., created the conditions for a more equal gender roles. An important role towards this direction was played by the development of the feminist movement, which highlighted the unequal treatment of women in society, promoted the gender equality, and claimed for social and political rights of women. These social transformations raise many similar issues in the Christian Church regarding the position of women and call for a review of its traditional positions. The first reaction came from the field of theology with the development of feminist theology. The feminist theology, as it was developed mainly in the West, in the Roman Catholic as well as the Protestant theology, is not just a supplement of traditional theology, but it constitutes a completely new concept in this field. The women themselves constitute the theological issue and begin to make theology from their experience, a theology that takes the form of liberation movements in two ways. First, by analyzing the concept, values, norms, and stereotypes developed in a patriarchal and monomer society, and secondly, by studying the consequences of patriarchal theology to women's lives, to the church and society. The Christian feminist theology uses the feminist approach as a tool for the analysis of reality and the critical thinking that honors not only women, but the whole community. The feminist theology appears in the 19th century, almost in a parallel with the feminist movement, and seek to change the structures of society and church beyond any patriarchal and man-centered thought. It is understood as a theology that liberates women and can formally join the ranks of feminist liberation movement in the 20th century. Like them, feminist theology started in America, where in 1819 it was published the first women's Bible by Elizabeth Cady, followed by many other women such as Katharina Hacks, Rosemary Radford Rather, Elizabeth Moltmann Wendell, Elizabeth Slusset Fiorenza, Mary Daly, Mary Gray, etc. The feminist theology generally seeks to understand the ecclesiastical history through the centuries away from the traditional models, which were invented almost exclusively by men and often underestimate women. All the texts of the Bible, Old and New Testament, were written by men for men, and even the history of Christianity during 2000 years shows the his story, that is the history of his, leaving only a little space for her story. The renewal of theological discourse through feminist theologians, but also the changes in the social roles of women, could not leave the church unaffected at an institutional level. The Protestant Church is the first to raise the issue of the ordination of women and seeks its solution through the ordination of women to middle and upper clergy. By contrast, the Roman Catholic Church, which remains largely traditional, is unaffected by these changes by insisting on a more traditional conception of the priesthood, denying the ordination of women. But what happens in the Orthodox Church? What is the position of women? What are the roles arising from this position? Are they auxiliary, complementary, or functional? Is the equal status of women and men recognized in the Orthodox Church? How does the Orthodox Church deal with the challenge of women's priesthood? Bringing these issues to the primitive church can enlighten us tremendously and offer us very interesting models of roles in order to discuss the position of women in the modern Orthodox Church. The New Testament, as the primary source of mapping the experience of the first Christian communities, is an ideal text for the search of an authentic way of living. In the evangelical text, there are many more feminine activities and roles that reflect the multifaceted aspects of feminine presence and put emphasis on feminine dynamism and potential. Well-known women such as the Myrophores, the women from Samaria, the sisters of Lazarus, Martha and Maria, Maria Magdalena, Elizabeth, Joanna, and par excellence, Maria the Theotokos, mother of Jesus, as well as many other anonymous women, constitute a gallery of portraits that represent the feminine potential in the ecclesiastical field. Particularly interesting is the reference to Martha and Maria as through their oppositional but at the same time complementary dimension. They may, on the one hand, contribute to the understanding of the functional roles of women, and on the other, delineate feminine models of action in the church. The phrase of Jesus, "Martha, Martha, you are worried and distracted by many things. There is a need of only one thing. Mary has chosen the better part, which will not be taken away from her," goes beyond the conventional attitudes of that time and paves the way for the creation of new roles for women. The two evangelical images of Martha and Mary describe two different perceptions for women, which in their turn prescribe the different roles that women are called to play in the Orthodox Church. They may be used as ideal types, as models in our effort to approach in a better way the position of women in the church and roles it entails. At this point, it is necessary to make clear that this approach is not a biblical hermeneutical reading, but an attempt for sociological analysis using sociological tools such as the ideal type. When analyzing typologically the two models of women, one can schematize the image of women and consequently the nature and character of the roles that derives from each one of them. The two models, Martha and Maria, as they are depicted in the evangelical text of Luke, typologically represent two different worlds with different social structure and relations. The static, hierarchical, and the patriarchal traditional society, and the open, equal, and participatory modern society. The traditional form of society is related to a specific distribution of positions, power, and work between the two genders, as well as distinct fields of action, which in their turn correspond to the distinction of space between private and public. The domestic private space, where the family concentrates its functions, constitutes the women's sphere, which women are responsible for. On the contrary, the public sphere in the wider political and social space that constitutes the space of responsibility and activity of men. This distribution is not equal, as the distinction between the two spheres and by extension the two genders creates an unequal distribution of power between men who are dominant and women who are subjugated. Men are the leaders responsible for all important decisions. Women are dominated, accepting passively the decisions of men, remaining true to their roles as wives, mothers, daughters. Men are attributed all superior work, such as the administration and powerful position in the public sphere, whereas women are responsible for menial tasks, such as keeping house and raising children. In modern societies, the public space is enlarged so as to accept women as equal members with roles that correspond to those of men and more participatory procedures in the allocation of positions and power. The key changes that defined modern society, such as industrialization, urbanization, and political liberalization, resulted in the change of the position and role of women. Women's entrance in the labor market, the expansion of education to both genders, the recognition of civil, political, and social rights played an essential role in the free formation of the personality of women and in their claim for an equal place in the social and political field. Having this in mind, we could say that the model of Martha corresponds to the traditional social structures according to which women are restricted to the private sphere, have no say in public affairs, remain silent in the public space, and even cover their head. The decisions they make concern domestic issues relating to their household and children, while the public issues, administrative and financial responsibilities, are in concern of men. They remain hidden in the home kitchens, having the absolute responsibility of the necessary yet menial jobs and roles, without any prospect of education or social participation. But Christ praises the other type, Maria, who leaves the kitchen and sits by his feet and listens to him. She becomes a student of his, giving priority to perfection and salvation as a full member of the community. She is the kind of woman who follows the teacher as an equal student to men. She is sanctified, saved, and eventually reaches the theosis. She expresses the effort of the woman to function as a full and equal member of the new society, which Christ himself inaugurates and realizes. So the model of Maria expresses a society that is open to women's participation. Women are given the opportunity to fight for a position in the public sphere, perform a variety of roles, offer diaconia to the community and broader society, depending on their gifts. This model is closer to that of modern women who claim an equal position in society alongside men and perform a variety of roles at many levels of modern life. political, financial, professional, educational, and so on. The image of Maria seated in the feet of Jesus, listening attentively to him, actually represents modern women who afford enriched possibilities to participate and offer her talents, her charisma, in a variety of ways in the Christ. The model of Martha expresses the traditional conception regarding the position of woman, which considers her marginalized. This conception, related to the old world, appears as insufficient and unfair to all women, which is why Christ himself faces it in a skeptical and mocking way. On the contrary, Christ, who inaugurates a new world, pays a compliment to Mary and condones to search and conquest of an equal position for women at an ontological, charismatic level in the first step, in the first level, and by extension, at a social institutional level, at least in the frame of community, but why not in the frame of a broader society? The supremacy of Martha over Maria in the ecclesiastical field. Which type of woman is promoted in the context of the ecclesiastical community, Martha or Maria? Christ seems to accept the second role, that of Maria, but the church seems to give priority to the role of Martha. The differentiation between the two roles of Martha and Maria reflects the confrontation within the church itself, that is between the institution and the charisma. The institutional role of the woman appears to be different and does not coincide with the charismatic one. The distinction between institution and charisma, a frequent distinction in the field of sociological research, also affects the Orthodox Church. Despite the fact that the role of Maria is well accepted, the role of Martha gradually acquires a bigger importance through the ages, following a parallel course with the establishment of the institution of the Church. While on the charismatic theological level, the equal position of Maria in the ecclesiastical community is recognized, on the institutional sociological level, it is Martha who survives, expressing specific roles of discrimination and submission that are widely accepted and established. More specifically, on the theological charismatic level, the image of Maria is dominant. The official teaching of the Church projects the equal position of woman concerning salvation, sanctification, and theosis. As a consequence, the woman can be sanctified and reach theosis without her feminine nature posing a problem. By contrary, on the institutional level, the woman seems to be inferior to man. The deaconates and charismata, which she had in the early Church, have disappeared. Because of the institutionalization of the Church, the ecclesiastical context favored the type of Martha, promising for the future, in an eschatological and charismatic perspective, a better position for the type of Maria. In reality, though, Martha never transforms to Maria. On the contrary, the arguments which are used justify and preserve the position of women is ideally expressed as equal to that of man. The actual roles of women do not respond to this position. To be more concrete, we try to study the position of a woman through specific examples. In the new community that was inaugurated by Jesus, called Ecclesia, the abilities and gifts of women were used by the early church in a very positive way, and efforts were made to even out differences regarding women's participation. In the early Christian communities, women perform a variety of roles, contributing actively and their better function. This is favored, of course, by the fact that the Eucharistic life takes place mainly in the domestic sphere, that is, oikos. As the public gathering of the Church of Christ believers takes place in homes and sees itself as a community that affords family characteristics, each organization provides opportunities for women to participate actively. The citation of the Apostle Paul concerning the position of woman is fundamental. In the Epistle of the Galatians, he mentions that there is no male or female, you are all in Christ. In this citation, brought deaconates and functions to women analogous to those of men, and it led women to play an active role in the first church. So, along with the traditional role of wife and mother, women adopt within the community a set of new unexpected roles, such as those of the missionary, charismatic prophetesses, teachers, and social workers. Especially the role of deaconesses in the ancient church confers an institutional upgrading to the position of women at that time, at least within the community. This institution is created with a view to exercising social as well as liturgical work, since deaconesses take up tasks such as baptizing women and offering the Eucharist. Irrespective of the fact whether deaconesses had the permission to be ordained or not, the institutional recognition of their role within the community indicates a relative improvement of their position compared to the one they hold in the surrounding society. But very early, the gradual institutionalization of the church created a kind of distribution of works, of labor. The Apostle Paul himself, even though he had many women collaborators to his missionary work, did not avoid the institutionalization of the church according to the existing social models. He adopts the patriarchal and the hierarchical structure, which was predominant in social organizations. Regarding her status in the family, the woman must obey the men. Furthermore, in the ecclesiastic community, it is forbidden for women to sermonize and in general have an active role. There is an inconsistency between the fundamental declaration of the equality of women on the one hand and the position of submission on the other that is present in his pastoral epistles. Insofar as the church is shaped and reshaped by society and conforms to the broader social conditions, it is gradually transformed into a patriarchal and androcentric institution that places women in a submissive position. Given these conditions, the multifaceted roles of women in the primitive community is restricted so that it finally coincides with that society requires of them. To limit themselves in the private domestic sphere of activities and deal with their own household and not with the affairs of community and consequently society. Despite the theological thesis of the church on the equality between the two genders at an ontological charismatic level, the positions taken by the faithful men and women in the ecclesiastical body gradually come to correspond to the position they have in the broader society. So very soon, for women to speak and teach in church, so the roles of teacher and prophetesses weakened and finally vanished. The unilateral interpretation of St. Paul's passages, together with a compulsory silence in the public worship and the coverage of the head, heralds the hierarchical subordination of women to men. This is directly related to the rearrangement of space. For as long as the church belongs to the private domain, being persecuted and marginal, different roles, regardless of gender, were developed and adopted by its members, and the participation of all was essential and true. When the church, after the official recognition, becomes part of the public domain, and identifies with it, it accepts the division of social roles and reproduces the dominant social hierarchy. With the public recognition of the church, especially after the fourth century, deaconesses were excluded from public functions of community, such as teaching, baptism, and the Eucharist, and limited to the provision of social care. The institution of deaconesses as such flourishes especially during the era of great fathers, 5th century, with Olympiad being the most famous diaconis, collaborator of Saint John Chrysostom. The sectors of feminine diaconia are many, and they cover many areas of the diverse social and philanthropic work of the church that involves a variety of activities, especially during the early Byzantine period. The deaconesses worked mainly in ecclesiastical hospitals and philanthropic institutions. They cared for the sick, the poor, the prisoners, and the elderly. They were responsible for keeping the church clean and in order. They gave the sign to women for the participation in the standing of the congregation and also introduced the kiss of peace among them. In the sources, reference is also made to their active participation in the enshrouding funeral and burial of deceased Christian women, as well as the consolation of their relatives. Over the centuries, however, the institutional recognition of the role of deaconesses, even in the form of social work that is it held in Byzantine society, gradually degenerates, and around the 10th century, it ceases to exist. The gradual identification of society and church affects the latter, that eventually comes to reflect the patriarchal and hierarchical social structures. The church is consequently led to the acceptance of the strictly distinct fields of action for women and men following society standards. Women get more and more confined into the private sphere, and emphasis is placed on the model of good mother and wife that mostly connect women with the family rather than the model of social worker that is associated with the public sphere. The equality between men and women, if and when it is recognized theologically, is interpreted in a soteriological and eschatological way, without affecting the historical ecclesiastical body. The fact that there is a rich life and organization in the feminine monastic life during the Byzantine period contributed to all the above. In the monastic life, the woman acquires value and competes with the man on equal terms in the ascetics, surpassing the weakness of her nature and acquiring masculine virtues. In this context, the discrimination between the two genders does not exist and the equality is accomplished. But the monastic life, having a charismatic dimension, remains in the margin of the ecclesiastical life and organization. At the same time, the activity of women within the church is gradually reduced, for instance, with the abolition of the institution of deaconesses, the female monasteries rise in number and importance, as they are headed especially towards the end of the Byzantine Empire, with women from the upper classes. We could suppose that function as an outlet for the suppressed efficiency of women. The discrimination between men and women and the devaluation of the latter is established during the Ottoman Empire, if we speak for Balkans, and it is due to the well-known political and social reasons. The same position is reflected after the liberation of the constitution of the new Greek state in an encyclical of the Holy Synod in the 19th century. In this encyclical, the Greek Orthodox Church considers the customs of the separate seating arrangement of men and women within the church an authentic and holy tradition. Therefore, the attitude of the Holy Synod preserves for a long time and reproduces the traditional position of women according to the patriarchal and hierarchical ideals. The hierarchy of the sexes and the social reality, with the man responsible for all the public activities and the woman responsible for the private ones, is accepted and justified by the ecclesiastical community. In this way, the dominant conceptions that have been historically established become stronger and more valid. The work of the church in all its dimensions, liturgical, pastoral, administrative, social, and educational, is gradually concentrated in the hands of men, especially of the clergy. leaving women aside. In the structure and distribution of the ecclesiastical work, as this is expressed in a variety of areas, women hold auxiliary, complementary roles, which are socially rather than ecclesiologically defined, and are kept away from positions of authority, excluded from administrative or liturgical duties. In the traditional Greek society, for example, of the late 19th century, as the one of the island of Skiathos, for example, one can get a taste of the auxiliary presence of women in the priest's work. In the liturgies of small chapels, as described in the work of Papadiamandis, a Greek novelist, women keep the church and yard clean and in good order, make altar bread, the fuel candle and oil lamps, and so on. This image is not far from contemporary descriptions of the duties of women in the early 21st century in Greece, which reflect a significant part of current ecclesiastical views, at least in the Balkans. According to them, women's work is limited to dealing with the simple tasks of daily worships in the parish, such as the propriety of the church, preparation of altar bread, organization of festivals, reading the names in the family diptychs by the priest, caring for funerals and memorial services to the deceased. In this way, while society changes and continually accepts new roles for women, the church is still limited to a closed traditional worldview where gender roles remain strictly defined. Consequently, the diaconal contribution of women is easily accepted as long as it is limited to traditional sectors, always in an auxiliary form without disturbing the established order of ecclesiastical structure. This diaconia, beyond its actual value, due to the fact that it is offered by women silently as a gift of love, is faced by the ecclesiastical milieu as absolutely normal, as an extension of women's housekeeping roles in the family. But this does not certainly mean a full and equal participation of women in the entire work and function of the church, which could necessitate a certain upgrade and institutional recognition of women's participation. In modern society, especially after the Second World War, the position of women gradually changes. The combination of different factors, such as the urbanization, the participation of women in the financial production, the right to equal education, the right to vote, transformed the traditional position of women in the society. New presuppositions are created for real participation in the economic, political, and cultural life, and women take the challenge. The new roles which women are called to play make necessary a revision of their position. The discussions over the subject of women on a theoretical level and the vindications of the feminist movement help towards this direction. These changes unavoidably led to the Orthodox Church, as well as the other churches also, to face and discuss the situation and eventually redefine, at least theoretically, the position and the role of women. The crucial point which provoked this discussion was the question of ordination of women, which was posed by the Protestant churches. Another point was the new readings of the Bible with a criteria of the new exegetical science and the revival of patristic studies. Here's the contribution of the feminist theology also, which gave a new dimension to the ontology and the anthropology of the feminine personality. The inter-Orthodox symposium, the place of women in the Orthodox Church and the question of the ordination of women, which took place in Rhodes, 1988, was very important and took the subject a step further towards this direction. On the occasion of the ordination of women, the Symposium of Rhodes insisted on the traditional position of the Orthodox Church, but noted that the institution of deaconesses should renew. Furthermore, there was an opportunity to discuss the place and the role of women in the church in general. The symposium recognized the unique place of women regarding salvation, principally via the role of Theotokos, and at the same time, it recognized the need for a more complete participation of women in the life of the church. In a parallel way, the W3CC, the World Council of Churches, devoted the decade 1988-1998 to women. The ecumenical decade constituted an answer posed by the churches, the ecumenical movement, and the world in general. It was partially an answer to the decade of the United Nations for the women, 1975-1985, which, despite being successful in some aspects, did not manage to approach and provide solutions to the problems of women around the world. In the framework of ecumenical discussions, there were various tendencies. The participation of the Orthodox Church, represented by women theologians, gave the opportunity to re-examine the ontology of the female being and to search in the patristic and ecclesiastical tradition for the basis which the true value of women is built upon. At this point, we should mention that the change in the traditional position of women in modern society affected the church in a double way. On the one hand, it made the church re-examine the position of women, as we have already mentioned, and on the other, it gave the opportunity to many women to study theology. In this way, the pressure for the redefinition of women theologians are influenced by the revival of patristic studies and the theology of the person. In a parallel way, because of their training in theology, the church came to appreciate the potential of women and use them for teaching and catechetical purposes. In the meantime, in recent years, a group of Orthodox women theologians has begun to form a different discourse in the field of Orthodox theology, a female discourse that seeks to reveal the presence of women in the Orthodox Church. This feminine theological research is developed through various axes, such as the biblical interpretation, the socio-historical analysis, or the systematic theological approach. The biblical interpretation has the purpose to review the biblical text, seeking there the living participation of women of the primitive church who have been buried by the male-dominated and patriarchal society. The socio-historical analysis looks for the position and the roles of women who participate in the formation of the community, but remain invisible in the course of the history of the church. The systematic approach attempts a feminist reading of the fundamental elements of the Orthodox theology, the revelation, the ecclesiology, or the eschatology. We should mention here the important contribution of the Center of Ecumenical, Missiological, and Environmental Studies, Metropolitan Panteleimon Papageorgiou, to the discussion on the issue of women in the Orthodox Church with the organization of two important, in terms of topics and participations, international conferences. At the first conference held in Thessaloniki at the beginning of 2015, with a theme, Deaconesses, the Ordination of Women and Orthodox Theology, a dynamic presentation was attempted on all issues related to women's participation in the Orthodox Church, with particular emphasis on the issue of deaconesses and the ordination of women. At the second conference, that was also held in Thessaloniki at the beginning of 2020, with the theme Deaconesses, Past, Present, Future, a kind of evaluation of the previous conference was attempted, as well as that of possible efforts for the more active participation of women in the church. Professor Vasiliadis, who was the soul of these conferences, can give us more detailed information about these conferences. To the end, if the change of the social conditions activated women in the public sphere, we believe that the theology of the Orthodox Church does not put obstacles to similar activities in the ecclesiastical sphere. As a matter of fact, it is unfair for the Orthodox Church to support that, as far as ontology and salvation are concerned, women are equal to men, but such a thing is not evident in daily practice. It is contradictory that the Orthodox women, on the one hand, make decisions as equal members in political and administration centers, and on the other, do not even participate in parish or bishop councils. The church should not be considered as incapable of keeping up with social developments. In the case of women, similarly to other cases, it has its own presuppositions to blaze new trails toward this direction. If we want women to have a more balanced positions in the church, we always have the possibility to resort to the proto, to the primitive Christian experience. More specifically, in the primitive Christian church, there are the presuppositions for the amelioration of the institutional position of women. The contemporary church should search there for the most authentic and spontaneous attitudes that are inspired by the charismatic situation of the first Christians. A serious problem which the church faces in general is the importance of the institutions acquired at the expense of the charismatic dimension. Many times a social matter is referred to us a holy tradition of the church. We must distinguish between the essence and the cover, the non-changeable and the constantly changing cultural influences. Moreover, we should not forget that the position of women in the church is a subject of discussion nowadays because of the big social changes and the development of the feminist movement, which encourages women to realize and improve their position. As we understand from all the above, it is absolutely necessary in our days to turn the words of the Apostle Paul into action. In addition to his words, St. John the Laemon mentions in the 6th century that we are all equal, therefore we must be equal. So the church should trust women and give them the position they deserve and take full advantages of their abilities and charismata the way society does. Most often, the symbolic structure of the roles seems to be more important than their typical fulfillment. The roles are constructed on the basis of daily social practices and are consolidated with habit. This way, they become internalized, and that is why they are difficult to change. Therefore, women should first restore to the conscience of the Christians, and then they can play the roles that are suitable to their charismata. It is time for the church to accept that Martha and Maria are the two different sides of the same persons, which is the Christian woman of today. Nowadays, after the renewal of theological discourse over the past decades, we are able to argue about a theology of equality that faces positively the feminine persons and recognizes gender equality. Even the negative positions against the priesthood of women is attributable to the reasons of tradition rather than theological reasons. Yet the ecclesiastical reality is inconsistent with the theological discourse. As Elizabeth Berzizel, a French Orthodox theologian, points out, in the Christian milieu, some conservative groups accuse the inferiority of women and their natural submission to men is not an issue. Nevertheless, we often talk about alterity, difference, a difference that supposedly assigns different social roles to men and women, different complementary spiritual missions. This position appearing as self-evident and despite the undeniable intention to recognize the professedly feminine qualities contains a lot of ambiguities. In practice, it often perpetuates in a special form the traditional subjugation of women, limiting them to menial roles under the control of men. The debate is open, and local Orthodox churches, depending on their specific conditions their members live in, have realized that they need to answer the underlying questions hidden behind the theological self-sufficiency. Several initiatives that have been taken in recent years, either under the pressure of society or the pressure of the other churches and the World Council of Churches, point towards the need for empowerment of the role of women in the ecclesiastical body and their active participation in ecclesiastical life. The Inter-Orthodox Theological Conference of Rhodes put forth specific proposals for the full development of women's attributes, such as reviving the institution of deaconesses, taking up positions of authority in the ecclesiastical administration, appointing representatives in the ecumenical movement, as well as providing diaconia as readers, chanters, social care providers, and so on. This decision could only be the first steps toward the full and equal participation of women in the body of the Christ, of the Church, since both the development of the theology of the person and the requirements of contemporary society and knowledge for contribution of women in the social arena, and so the way to their full recognition at every level. Women that study acquire professional experience and have positions of authority in many sectors of social life are also capable of offering their knowledge and experience to the broader liturgical, administrative, pastoral, and educational work of the Church. Making the best out of women's as well as lay people's potential constitutes a dynamic perspective for the Church. This realization, however, is difficult and implies on the deeply rooted patriarchal structure and attitudes of the Church as an institution that holds it captive in an absolute, oftentimes beautiful past, and create a confrontation between theology and the ecclesiastical praxis. In the early 21st century, the old-fashioned work of women expressed by Martha remains important and maintains its value. Nevertheless, the Church should take seriously into consideration the dynamics expressed by Maria, respectfully accept women as equal to men, recognize the central role to play in the ecclesiastical body, provide the necessary institutional frame for the recognition of the work women offer, seek new ways for the development of feminine gifts, discover new operation models so as to transform itself into a participatory, decentralized, democratic, and member-centered church, functioning as a body that provides space and opportunities for both Martha and Maria. These two evangelical images of Martha and Maria best describe the way towards the full and active participation of women in the multidimensional and multifaceted ecclesiastical life. The development of these models offer unlimited possibilities both to the Church in order to make the best of the rich contribution of women at all levels, and the women themselves so as to offer from the position they wish their multifaceted diaconia to the Church. Thank you very much, and sorry for my English.
We thank you, Professor Papageorgiou. It was an excellent presentation, full of insights, and issues to be further elaborated. Thank you also for this social approach, sociological approach you made on a biblical, actually, subject, because the story comes from the Bible, as you have so beautifully analyzed it. And allow me to make, as a responder, the first comment before I give the floor to the other ladies, academics of this master program, who have joined us in this presentation. And my comment is from a hermeneutical or a biblical perspective, to see a little bit the importance of Jesus Christ allowing women to discipleship. What Maria was doing was exactly what the apostles, the male disciples, were doing, listening to what their Lord were saying. Among them, Maria was sitting at his foot, in fact, becoming a real disciple. And that was extraordinary for that context, for that environment. That's why Martha was complaining for Maria not following the rules of the society, the model one you mentioned. And since we are in a master program, I would like to remind especially our students how important it is to make a critical analysis of our sources. The Old Testament, we know all, exemplifies patriarchal bias in many ways, notably by the metaphor of woman coming out of men from the Genesis, the first chapter in Genesis. However, it is inescapable that this bias, patriarchal bias or whatever, like the model you have analyzed from a sociological perspective, was corrected in the New Testament, notably by the Pauline explicit statement that is being reported in his epistle to the Galatians, chapter 4, verse 4. When the set time had fully come, Paul said, God sent his son born of a woman. Now, God becoming incarnate, now we're coming to theological now, not only hermeneutical, not a God becoming incarnate from a woman, is in fact a reversal of a woman coming out of man. And this is in agreement with the numerous occasions in the New Testament, especially narratives, that of course are accepted theologically, but in practice we still need, as you said at the conclusion, to take position, to take at least a step forward. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free, nor is there male and female, for all of us, all you are, St. Paul said, are one in Christ Jesus. Again, from the Epistle to the Galatians. So we see the theological discipline in various departments, biblical, patristic, archaeological, exemplifying important elements of the role of women. You mentioned something in your speech about the first stage of the Christian in the so-called house church, not in the private domain, not in the public domain, and then other social factors that have caused even the so esteemed order of deaconesses to fall in disuse. So this is my first and only comment. I thank you once again, and I would like to invite your colleagues. I'll start with Professor Stathokosta, and later with Dr. Athanasopoulou to make any comment or any question. Now, Professor Stathokosta, are you ready to...
Thank you, Professor. I'm not ready because I didn't know that I should okay. say something.
No, no problem. Later, you can enter into discussion. What about you?
No, I will say Daniel? Something.
Okay, please.
Okay. I want to thank Niki as well. And
thank you.
I don't know if we have still things to say about this critical matter, because all these years we discuss again and again, and we write and we read and we discuss again, and eventually we do not see anything new coming into our community life. I think that changes are made by persons themselves, by communities, because of certain needs of them. Let me speak more practically. We know that in the past, chanting for a lady in the church was not permitted. Later on, we can see that in many churches, next to the chanter, the singer, the male, there is a little girl staying and trying to sing. That means that the father or the grandfather brings the female child to the church and teach her to sing. That is a change that happens due to practical and sentimental reasons. The father or the grandfather loves the female child. That's why he takes her with him and gives her this gift of learning how to sing in the church. And little by little, this practice persuades the priests, the clergy, to accept female persons to sing in the church. I mean that if we need something, if we have a need, then we find a way to gain it, to take it. And I wonder, what about young women today? We have so many female theologians, so many. In the university, the Theological Faculty of Athens, it's almost 50-50%, the percentages, female students and male students. So we have this very rich dynamic, female dynamic. Where are they in the church?
Yes.
Do they have anything to cover?
In liturgy.
I beg your pardon? They
only,
do not participate
in the church life, in the core of the church life, in liturgy too.
They do not participate too much in liturgical life. So one can pose this question, where are they? And I would like to pose a question to Niki. I'm a little bit confused these days about contemporary, modern women in Greece. Do you think that they are Marys or Marthas? They are faithful and dynamic, or faithful and pathetic, subordinated? That's all I can say. Thank you.
Thank you, Vasiliki.
Can I answer now?
Yes.
Vasiliki, tell me, what about in general? You speak in general, the women, the Greek women in general, because.
According your understanding, your perception,
because
the society of Greece,
according to the statistics, we belong to the Orthodox Church, 89%, etc. But we don't practice. So I don't know if we can speak about Greek women in general. Maybe we can speak about women in the church. In this case, I think that women in church is, how say, they are okay. They do not, not pose a problem. They accept their position in the church. They accept this traditional place in the church. They think that is the traditional place. We must stay like this because this is the tradition of the church. The other women outside the church, they don't interest in that.
So we need education.
We need education for women, at least there are in the church. In the community.
Okay.
The practicing Christians, I think the most of them women, do not interesting in changing all this. Many times we have many discussion with our students also, my students. The most of them, they do not interesting.
So there is not any need for women to participate more.
Maybe they do not realize the need to change. They accept as a holy tradition. They accept it as a holy tradition.
Okay. Let's take also another question or remark by Dr. Spiridoula Thanasopoulou, who next month will give a similar lecture again of this gender sensitivity, Bible translations and gender inclusive language. And after... After her, also Father Pavlos Koumargianos may need. I have also received a question by our student Jeffrey, and he will pose it himself later. But let's go to Dr. Athanasopoulou.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Professor Niki Papageorgiou, for this excellent talk on a very difficult issue, and you pointed out the contradiction that exists between teaching and practice. We have in theory, we have a theoretical and theological equality, but not in practice. Thank you very much for making this very, very clear. But I would like also to thank Professor Stathokosta for raising this issue about the need for change. And and thank you very much for what you said, Niki Papageorgiou, that it's actually women themselves who do not wish to change things in the church. I'm not a sociologist, and I will not pose a theological question to you. but I will pose a sociological question. Because today I realized how important this is, sociology. So I wonder if you have an idea, because personally I have not come across a study on that, but this is because I'm not into sociology, maybe that's why I don't know. You pointed out that urbanization, for instance, changed things within society. So basically, feminist movements pushed the church to discuss certain maybe issues. This is the same all over Europe. Let's talk about Europe, that Europe greater, Europe, not Eastern, Western, but Europe. Let's take this geographical space. Similar changes happened within Europe, similar. But we saw from the beginning of the 20th century a change in Protestant churches. Why did this happen? For instance, the ordination of women happened in the West, as we say, but not in the Catholic Church. So we have women living, say, in Germany, and if you are a Protestant woman, you can get ordained. If you are a Catholic, you cannot. But, or if you are an Orthodox, you cannot. A minority, of course, there are a few, I suppose, Orthodox in Germany. But they, all these women are part of a quite secularized culture, modern state. So what happened, and we saw this equality being realized in Protestant churches and not in Catholic and Orthodox? That's my question. If we have if you can give us an idea, if you have thought about that. Because since we are in ecumenical also course, and it's quite important to understand why. We live in the same Europe. Mm-hmm. We share things. We have many similarities, a Protestant woman and me. You know, we are also Christian. We share the same values, like democracy. We are in the EU. What?
If I can answer in this, I could answer, I could say that it was exactly the role of Protestantism in the new ages, let's say. The role of Protestantism, it's considered as open new condition, new ways of life in many levels. Some researchers consider that all the changes, the transformation of from traditional to modern society is due to Protestantism renovation, revelation. I don't know. So if Protestantism function like this, as an open, pluralistic, democratic, let's say, worldview, I imagine all this had influenced also the women's role, the women's even in the community. I speak from a sociological point of view. There are also Professor Vasiliadis, I suppose that can help here. There are a lot of theological or ministry reasons. What is the role of ordination, etc., etc. Well, there are a lot of differences between Protestantism and the classical, let's say, dogma, such as Roman Catholic Church or Orthodox Church. But I think it's, if I speak sociologically or historically, it's the role of Protestantism that played a role also for the ministry of women, for the ordination.
Since we are talking about, now women also in Europe, and we have students, and Angelica is with us, and Jeffrey, Father Pavlos, allow me to give to them first a response or a question, if they have, in order to illustrate a little bit from their perspective, how they feel about this perennial problem we are discussing. Many, many aspects, in many, theological, liturgical, whatever make it. If Angelina is not ready, Jeffrey has placed a question. Please, Jeffrey, raise your question yourself. If he is not ready, he has raised his question, but it is in my smartphone, and I need to go out to find myself.
May I ask you, Niki? I'm sorry. Now I got the chance to ask you whether we have any research done on the views of women, everyday women, who participants, of course, in the church, churchgoers. What's their opinion on the ordination of women? If we have any research done on that.
No, I don't know.
Of course, that would give us an idea, think about the issue, because when they speak publicly, they refuse to state it clearly that they would be interested to become, say, priests. But they are reluctant to say so. But in a questionnaire that would be.
Oh, I don't know.
They would say exactly what they think, and then we would have from the ground an idea of what they think. So I propose maybe. But this is a very good idea as a research topic to see
what. It could be very interesting to have such a research.
Because that's how one can push for change, because one can prove that there are people interested in, say, becoming deaconesses or even get ordained.
I don't know if there is such a research.
I have found Jeffrey's question. He is apologizing because he is listening the entire lecture while traveling, and he can't talk since he is in the bus. But his question is simply the following. Was it had for Jesus Christ to name Maria among apostles, since the society was patriarchal? Maybe could this have changed issues in ordained ministries in the church? So this is the question raised by our student, Jeffrey Mugadishi.
I'm not sure that I understand well. If Christ
about whether Jesus has made Maria an apostle. Now, I think I am more...
Informally, yes. Eh?
Yeah.
Informally, yes.
As a biblical scholar to see, to say a little bit more. New Testament scholarship has reached a conclusion now that during Jesus of Nazareth ministry, women and men were equally disciples of his. And the way they are not mentioned as apostles does not mean that they did not act as apostles. Mary of Magdalene, for instance, was the first apostle, or the Samaritan woman, the first apostle before the other apostles becoming apostles to witness to the resurrection and then to the new, to the church. We have even in the New Testament clear examples. And if we look at the last chapter of the Romans, then the place of women or the position of women were equal to those of men. Paul addresses more to women in this last very important chapter which was rediscovered in the biblical scholar very recently. Till very recently, the 16th chapter of the Epistle to the Romans was only considered as practical. It's not practical. It's not only Phoebe, it was Junia who was called an apostle even before Paul was an apostle, and many, many other cases. And we have this kind of, let's say, educational development in our theology to help the church. The church, of course, needs to take very, very careful steps in order to retain the unity, because the unity is very important, not the unity at the expense of the truth, but unity can be achieved if the church takes, conciliarily, of course, careful step by step towards rediscovering the real message of Jesus Christ and the real message of the gospel of our faith. That was, I mean, a simple answer to Jeffrey's question. Any other? I haven't received any other question. I have checked now. I haven't received any other question. Normally we end at 6:30, but if something is being raised, either as a question or a remark, we
Angelina.
Can
Angelina wants
to... We give the floor again, the floor to our main speaker to close our today's very beautiful and, in my view, very insightful presentation.
We have a question.
Father Pavlos, I forgot Father Pavlos, if he has, because he is also a priest who knows the situation in the core of our faith, in the liturgy.
Yes, I have 2 points. Rather fast in order to not exceed the time limit. I have points that the last Sundays that we were under this limit of 9 persons in the church, I realized that all the persons who were the laity of our worship were women. And I said, where are the men? What's going on here? And percentageously, every Sunday, women are more than men, and they take Holy Communion and participate, being in number more than men. And the second point that I wanted to play is that the Orthodox Church, the Orthodox Church, would have to dare to ordinate women and see how the things go, to stay back and keep talking, that doesn't help. We have taught enough, I think. We have to dare to ordinate women and see how the thing goes. It might, by itself, it might go back. We don't know. We wish that it will be something beautiful and something teaching and something that is like the it belongs to the church. It is like that belongs to the church. This is what I want to say.
Father Pavlos' first comment coincides with the very, very positive message sent by His All Holiness, the Ecumenical Patriarch, to our symposium last year on deaconesses, past, present, and future. Recalling what our late professor and pioneer in the restoration of the order of deaconesses, Professor Evangelos Theodorou, mentioning what the place of women were for generations, for centuries in the church, doing everything in the family life and also in social life, actually preserving the church, not only being more faithful in the sacraments, in receiving the sacraments, but also in the whole life of the church. And that was very important, and we hope to publish this book, the proceedings of the second symposium on deaconesses. Now, Professor Papageorgiou, say the closing words in today's beautiful.
Just to thank you for meeting. All this interesting evening. We had the opportunity to discuss. We need more time, of course, to discuss all these themes, but I hope we will continue to discuss, at least to discuss, until to see something more practical, new, practical change.
For our students, let's remind that on Monday, you will give a lecture of his elective course, and for all our audience, our listeners, I would like to remind them that on Tuesday, the next open public lecture is by His Eminence Metropolitan John of Pergamon, Zizoulas, at the same time. Till then, for all who are listening and who will listen in the recorded part of our YouTube channel and our SEMES YouTube channel, have a good evening or good night or whatever, wherever you are, and see you next Tuesday.
Thank you very much, Professor Vasiliadis.
Thank you all.